My name is Mark Fomenko. As he was, Brother Robert was, saying my name. My wife's here, Kristen. We got married not too long ago, maybe 9 months now. Well, or it'll be 9 or 10 months. It's around that range. I never thought I was going to come to Baton Rouge and, get married and, be living there, working there, but the Lord changes our, thoughts or the direction we think that we have in our lives, the will we think that we are going to do. It seems like God changes it, and I praise Him for that. I was born in the country of Ukraine. My parents moved over to the U.S. after the USSR broke apart in 1996. After, broke apart, opened to come to America, and everybody there wanted to come to America. Because just even my parents tell me even back then, that they looked at the U.S. as, well, honestly, they thought that this nation was all Christian people, is what they thought, that lived here were only Christian people. But, when they came over here, they were shocked, it was right after the Christmas season, everything was good. But when Halloween showed up, they were shocked that, that this wasn't, what they thought it was. But, it's just, it's awesome, being from, the background, I suppose, of an immigrant coming over to the U.S. to see, the hand of God. And even, from what my parents went through, the Christian persecution there in the USSR for the faith. Now, people were truly persecuted for the faith in all various degrees and ways. And it wasn't just physical, beating type of thing, because my parents never went through that. But it was more of a verbal slash, demotion and job, that type of thing. Like my mom, made straight A's in school, was a great student, honors, but they wouldn't give her, the rewards they would give the, the next kid who was a communist. They would reward him instead. And they said, because you are a communist, you get this reward, and because she's a Christian, she gets nothing. Things like that over and over, the brainwashing of kids. And I know when my dad had to join the USSR military for 2 years, either you served the military or went to prison. The military is much better than prison. And he served as construction for the USSR, their military, Freshly, right when he got into the military, he just got saved. So 6 months, just saved, just got to know the Lord when he was 18 years old, and he just talked about how many people just they would hate speak negative. They would tell him, "I'm going to kill you." Several guys came to my dad and said, "We are going to kill you because you are a Christian. We don't like you." Interesting, thing happened. My dad started praying to God, and every single one of those men that said they were going to kill my dad, they all died in very gruesome deaths. I'm not going to, describe it, but they all were all together. They all individually all died very gruesome deaths. So, that's how when God protects you. God shields you. You don't hope that for the person who's opposing you. But when you mess with God's child, right. Amen. There's always going to be a result, a penalty for that. And we moved to Washington State, Bellingham, Seattle area. Then we moved over to Tennessee because, Washington State in around 2002-03 were experiencing the loss of job, all that stuff. Before it hit the recession in 2007, there they experienced it a little bit earlier. With construction and stuff. So my dad, one day, looked at maps, said, "I want to go to Atlanta, Georgia." There wasn't a job. So he went to Chattanooga, Tennessee, and found a job there. And honestly, I believe it was God that sent us to Tennessee, because there, when we just moved, 6 months later, 7 months later, something, I don't know if you guys heard of it before, but something called Sunlight Radio started up. It started in Graysville, Tennessee, and it covered Cleveland, Tennessee, Chattanooga, Tennessee area. I'll tell you, from then on, when I started hearing as a kid, I was maybe 12 years old, 11, 12. But from hearing, I would listen to the message of the cross. I'd listen to Francis and Friends as a kid. And I knew that the power of God was there. At first, I didn't like their music. I thought it was too country. Coming from Washington, we weren't used to that kind of culture. You know, people with the accents and all that kind of stuff. But I remember listening, by 11, 12 years old, listening to the message of the cross. And I felt the presence of God come upon me. And I was just crying. I didn't even know. I didn't understand what he was talking about. I thought that's what everybody preached. Brother Swagger, we talk about the message of the cross, and I started listening more and more and more, and I became, the fanatic in my family.
Amen.
And it spread to others. And my parents, we went first time in 2006, because my parents heard of Jimmy Swagger back in, Ukraine, but they didn't really know too much about him, even if they heard about him, because they didn't have television. In 2006, we came for a Thanksgiving camp meeting. I have 8 brothers and sisters. So we all packed into the van, 10, 11 of us, and we went all in one van all down there to Baton Rouge. Remember, we got to a hotel. We all stayed in one, two-bed hotel, because my parents, weren't rich, so they just piled us in there. And I remember going to the first time. It was a Wednesday night service for Thanksgiving came in 2006, and I knew, everything was awesome. I didn't realize how big the ministry was and, all that kind of stuff. But when I got there, I was like, wow. And then we left after Brother Larson's sermon that next day. My parents didn't want to get another day hotel, so we ended up leaving, but it always left an impact. And then 2007, came to a crossfire when they had them at the Blue Bonnet Towers. We'd stay in the dorm room. I remember, I believe also God placed me there in 2007 because there, I'll be honest with you, I grew up, I never knew that people, other cultures, other people could be saved. As I said, I grew up Ukrainian, Russian teaching, what the church taught, very rules and regulations. Woman couldn't wear pants. Woman can't wear makeup. Just all that stuff. It was a Pentecostal Russian church, but not a holiness or type of thing. It's very complicated. It's just it really is trying to describe it, but they didn't. They were Pentecostal, but they didn't believe in running, dancing, shouting. They didn't believe in playing drums. That was like a big thing. They didn't believe in drums. All that kind of stuff. They were Pentecostal, there's one thing that they did know was how to pray. They would always kneel in prayer, a kneel or stand. They didn't believe in sitting in prayer. But when they would start praying, the glory of God will always show up. It's interesting even back then that the prophecies given were always prophecies, look to me, I'm your answer. Look to me, what I have done. But, I was growing up, I never understood it, But even God, through people that were in legalism and religion, God was telling them to look to Him, but they continually would reject Him, His way. And then 2007, I came to Crossfire. Like I said, I grew up in a, Russians are generally white. So I didn't even know that a black person or Mexican could even really be saved. Because they really taught me that it's only, it's us who are going to heaven. And everybody else they refer to as American, they're all lost, they're all worldly, but we are the only ones that have the truth. But when I came in 2007, God placed me on a floor that was generally people from Mississippi, Torrance Nash, Mario Nash. He had a youth group there, 40, 50, and I don't think one of them was white. And they had a Hispanic group from Dallas or Houston. So I was, one of the few white people on the floor. And just awesome, for the first time in my life, I saw people that were different than me speaking in tongues, praying. The power of God would show up. I saw people literally change. They came in looking completely different. I remember this man from Chicago, Illinois. He was a gangster. His hair, he had the hair up maybe down to his waist. I'm talking about baggy clothes, chains on. Literally, within days, he got a haircut. He started putting a belt on his pants. Nobody had to tell him, hey, you need to do this. I know several days, the Spirit of God literally touched him, saved him, filled him with Spirit, and called him to go to Bible college. And, you know, that's what God does. When the message is preached right, that's what God does. You know, that's what, you know, I literally changed my life. And I went 2007, 8, 9, 10, 11. And then, you know, while those years were going on, I knew, you know, that God had called me to preach and I needed to go to Bible college. But, the, you know, things got in the way in my life and God had to literally remove them out of the way. And when I was ready in May 2012 for the fall semester, I came to Bible college. And I'll tell you, you know, even going year after year to Crossfire, I still wasn't used to, you know, people shouting, people dancing. I still wasn't used to, even if I came, listened to ministry, it was so foreign to me. It was weird because I would still go to the same old church all the time, but they didn't do that. But over time, I started noticing that, you start tapping your foot after a while, you know, you start clapping. It doesn't become foreign to you. You start lifting your hands. It's not foreign to you anymore. You know, you start praising God. You know, and that's, you know, and I want to emphasize, that's what the message of the cross does. You know, I'm a living proof of that. You know, I skip through a lot of stuff because, you know, I could talk for hours, you know, about that. But that's, you know, what God does, you know. And then in 2000, and, you know, then I came back for a second year, you know, and then I met her. You know, we started talking, you know, here and there. We weren't, you know, I never believed in dating, so we didn't never, we didn't really date, I suppose, but we started talking, you know. And I went to Alaska to work for, you know, 5 months in construction. And when I came back, you know, I proposed to her because I talked every single day with her, at least an hour a day. Always on the phone. That was, you know, my, a routine to do. I had to call her and talk to her. And, you know, and I praise God that, you know, through, you know, one man's ministry, one message, you know, that God really brought everything together. There's people now from the church that I used to be part of that left the church. Some are moving down to Baton Rouge. And just awesome to see what God does, you know, that God took us out, you know, completely changed. And, you know, it's a true blessing. Amen. Let's get to Matthew chapter 26, verse 36 through 44. Then cometh Jesus with them unto a place called Gethsemane, and saith unto the disciples, sit ye here while I go and pray yonder. And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and began to be very sorrowful and very heavy. Then saith he unto them, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here and watch with me. And he went a little further and fell on his face and prayed, saying, O my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. And he cometh unto the disciples and findeth them asleep and saith unto Peter, what, could ye not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. He went again the second time and prayed, saying, O my Father, if this cup may not pass away from me, except I drink it, thy will be done. And he came and found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy. And he left them and went away again and prayed the third time, saying the same words. I want us to pray for the message.
Amen.
Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus Christ and ask you, Lord, that you would touch every single word that I speak, Lord, on this word that you have given to me. Ask you that you would touch, Lord, every single person in this place, that they would hear. You would open up our hearts and our lives, open my heart and my life, Lord, that we may follow after you fully and completely, Lord. That we would surrender everything to you, Lord, that we would submit to the way of the cross, submit to the way, Lord God, that you have already planned for us. And we ask you in Jesus' name, Amen. Amen. I want to give you a little bit of background. You know, Matthew here was writing. He was a publican, a sinner, and he's just giving an account, you know, a gospel of what Jesus did, what Jesus said to the Jewish believers. You know, geared towards, you know, Jewish believers, and showing to them that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, that He is the Messiah. And within these verses, you know, my desire that I want to bring out to you, you know, as Jesus, you know, says over and over and over, it's not my will, but thy will be done. That's what I want to bring out to you. The will of God to be done in your life. And not just for it to be done in your life, but how it is to be done in your life. How is the will of God supposed to be accomplished in your life? Because a lot of times, and I also, you know, grew up like this, that everybody told you to live a certain way. They said, live this, don't go there, don't watch movies, don't, you know, do this, don't do that. But they never told you how to do it. They never told you how to perform it. They just said, don't do it. And a lot of things I could just mention, you know, don't watch movies, they did have a good point to it. You know, that there's some movies we aren't to watch. But because they never understood the message right, they corrupted, their whole thinking was corrupted. It became legalism and law because they did not understand Christ right. And, you know, and that's why, you know, I want to emphasize, you know, first that to have the will of God done in our lives, we must understand how it is to be done in our lives and the way that God wants it to be done in our lives. And, you know, and that's really what I want to look at today. In Matthew chapter 26, verse 36 again, I'll read the first verse. Then cometh Jesus with them unto a place called Gethsemane, and saith unto disciples, sit ye here while I go and pray yonder. We see here that this was a time of right before Jesus was to be crucified. You know, we are in three and a half weeks until Easter or resurrection, I think, something like that. You know, we are in that time, the season. So, you know, and it was the same thing here. You know, we see here that it was right before Jesus was to be crucified, right before the sin debt was to be paid. And Jesus is spending his last moments with his disciples. We see that in John chapter 13, 14, 15, 16, 17. So Jesus spent a lot of his time, his last moments with the disciples last week, instilling into them, putting into them the truth of the gospel. He was putting it into them, telling them that the Comforter was going to come. He was telling them, you know, more about the Holy Spirit, more about Him, more about where they are going to go, more about what they should do, how they should do, how they should abide in Him. And, you know, that's what Jesus giving them, these commandments. And then we see, you know, Peter, you know, after Jesus is done saying all these things, we see Peter says, you know, Lord, maybe all these might deny you, but I'll never deny you. And Jesus said, no, you will deny me. You will deny me. And we see in another gospel that Jesus not only told him that he will deny him, but he said, I prayed for you that your faith fail not. Because he knew that Peter was going to fail. But he wanted to make sure that Peter's faith was going to remain strong through it all. And we see also the disciples also were the same. You know, here in Matthew, in Matthew chapter 26, it says the same thing that all the disciples said, we won't deny you. And right before Jesus goes to Gethsemane, he has the Last Supper, where he talks about, you know, the ordinance that we do today about the Lord's blood and, you know, and his body, symbolizing in the bread and in the grape juice, on what Christ was going to do for us on the cross. And after this, you know, that the disciples, you know, they come to, you know, know, it says here in Scripture, with them unto a place called Gethsemane. And the word Gethsemane means a place where olive oil is pressed. It was an olive press. And I don't know if you know how it looked like, but I looked up some pictures because I thought it was interesting how these olive presses were. And it was, you know, something you would think of more like a seesaw type of thing. And it had a stone in the middle and had wood that would come out, you know, and they would put, not sandbags, but, you know, different types of weight, you know, and they would put it on, you know, on the wood so it pressed down on the rocks, so, you know. And it's interesting that the more pressure they applied, the more oil came out. The more pressure they applied, the more oil came out. And that's the same today. The more pressure, the more oil. The more pressure, the more oil. That's where God wants to get us today, you know. And Jesus was there too, in a place called Gethsemane, in an olive press. Jesus was getting pressed. But he didn't flee from Gethsemane and say, "No, God, I'm not going to do your will." He didn't do that. But in Gethsemane came a time and a period in Christ's life that we can call the place of surrender. We see it here in the prayer. He prayed it three times. He said, "God, not my will, but your will be done." And it says that he came back to the disciples, came back again and prayed. He continually prayed the same prayer. He said, "God, not my will, but your will be done." It was a place of surrender. Jesus, as God in the flesh, wanted the will of his Father to be done. How much more we who are flesh and no God need for him to do the will of God in our life? You see, Jesus, like I said, he was God manifest in the flesh. And he needed the will of God to be done in his life. He sought the will of God in every aspect. We, as the children of God, need the same and even more, really. We need to seek the face of God even more. And I want to, before I go on, I want to give you the definition of surrender. It means a yielding or giving up, to give the control or use of your life to God. See, that's what Jesus was doing. He was yielding himself up to the control of God. That's what surrender is. Surrender isn't eating a Big Mac when you want it. That's not surrender. That's just, what we call self-control. You know, that's not surrender. You know, or people go through Lent for 40 days. You know, some people say, I'm not going to drink Coke. I'm not going to watch video games. I'm not going to do this. I'm not going to clean the garage, you know, in 40 days. Or I'm not going to do this. You know, within these 40 days, you know. But that's not surrender. That's not giving nothing up, really. But this surrender I'm talking about, it's deeper. It goes to the heart of man. It's the complete surrender of your will to the will of the Father. See, God wants you to surrender everything to him. He doesn't want you just to surrender your family, say, "God, well, let your will be done in my family. God, let your will be done in my job. I want, you know, a raise and pay. I want this and that." But God, not to do his will in your life. God wants to start first within you before he starts with the family. But I notice that with my parents were the ones that, even if they did have their flaws and their mistakes and, you know, their belief systems a little bit different than mine, I saw them throughout all their life. They always sought the will of God. When they moved to Tennessee, when they bought their first house, when they bought their sold the house, they bought another house. They always were seeking the will of God. I grew up in that. My parents wouldn't say, "Mark, don't do this," and they would turn around and do it. You know, I see parents do that today. They say, "Kids, I work with people that are unsaved. And the dude I work with, he says to his grandkids, don't smoke. It's bad for you. But he himself smokes. You know, or don't eat this, but they themselves eat it. You know, I'm just very simple things. You know, but surrender has to take place first in you so it can affect other people around you. Because the best example that you can be to someone is an example that is living and breathing example. Not just a word, tongue, you know, just tell people how they should live, what they should not do, what they should do. But you should be living out your life to the point that people around you, you know, if you have children or, you know, family members should see the life of God flowing through you.
Praise God.
That's what God wants you to do, is to live that life of surrender. It's submitting to the will of God. And like I already said, that Jesus wanted the will of his Father done. That's what he wanted and only what he wanted. He wanted the will of the Father from the first moment, you know, that he was, you know, that the Spirit breathed into Mary to the moment he his ascension. Through all of that was Spirit-led and Spirit-controlled. To the time he was baptized in water by John, to the time he died on the cross. Every step he took was seeking the will of the Father, knowing the will of the Father, seeking his will. I have a point that I bolded here that I want to say. The will of the Father was the cross for Christ and is the cross of Christ for us. I want to say it again. The will of the Father was the cross of Christ, was the cross for Christ. And is the cross of Christ for us. That's the will of God. The will of God was for Christ to die on the cross. To shed his blood. That not only the penalty of sin is paid, but the power will be removed. And one day the whole presence of sin will be removed. That was the will and the plan of God. But for us, the will and plan of God for us today, as it says in Luke chapter 9, verse 23, for us to come after him, to deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. I love the word daily. Every single day, we are to surrender our will to the will of the Father, saying, Lord, it's not what I want for today, but I want your direction. I want your leading. I want your guidance. Lord, I want the cross to be manifest in my life. And I'll tell you, if there's times where it's so difficult and so hard to surrender to God, that's why Jesus left us the Comforter for. He left the Holy Spirit to continually point to him, to continually point to the cross. Because when you come to the cross, there's a death that has to occur. Amen. The cross always brings death. It doesn't matter how good you think you look, but God doesn't think you look good without Christ. He sees you as stinky, as ugly, or any word you can think of. God doesn't. You're literally vile before him because of your sin. You're tainted with sin. But when you come to him and his way, which is the way of the cross, and you say, Lord, forgive me of my sin. God, cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Lord, I accept you into my heart. Then God starts seeing you as righteous. He starts seeing you as pure. You know, it humbles you. And that's what it should do. When you know that the only way you can come to the Father is through Christ. And that one moment experience, we refer to as a born again experience. Salvation. But the problem is a lot of people leave that salvation experience and they forget what happened. They forget that they laid everything at the foot of the cross. They say, God, I can't live my life. Lord, I'm sinful. I'm wicked. God, I messed it all up. I need you in my life. And we pray that when we get saved, but then when we get up and we go on with our life, we try to do our way, our will, what we want done in our life. That's why people marry people they aren't supposed to. That's why people start churches they aren't supposed to. That's why people do even good things, you know, different professions in life. you know, becoming a doctor, a nurse, or, you know, or working, you know, even in Sunday school. But all those good things for society, for the church, but they haven't sought the will of God for it. There's many pastors out there that haven't sought the will of God to be the pastor. To be, you know, if God has called them in that, they just know, oh, this position needs to be filled, or this ministry needs to be filled. They need a Sunday school teacher, so since I'm saved, I want to be a Sunday school teacher. It doesn't work like that in any aspect. Your profession in life, your job, it doesn't matter what it is. You must seek the will of God. Say, God, I want your will and your will alone. It's so important. When, you know, going to which college you go to, you know, what job, you know, this job that I have, you know, I saw God. I said, God, open the doors, close doors that need to be closed. God, give me within my spirit for me to know that this is the job for me. And I thank God that God did close some doors and God opened other doors. You know, that's how God works. But the thing is, a lot of people, you know, pray and say, Lord, you know, I want you more in my life. God, I love you. I want more of you. But then God turns them down a direction they never thought they were supposed to go. They don't want no more to go down that direction. They don't want that job anymore. They want this job. You know, this $25 an hour job. But God's telling, go to this $23 an hour job. Don't go to this $25 an hour job. But you think within your own self that I know better. Oh, this $25 job pays $2 more. You know, better commissions, you know, better benefits, all that stuff. But in the future, you know, in 3 months, you don't even realize that this job might close. And this is where God wanted you to be so he can promote you in this job. That you would make $25 and more benefits than the other job. But a lot of times we're so nearsighted. We think so close. We think what we want at that moment. Oh, I want the pleasure. You know, I want this right now. I want it right now. That we, you know, that we forsake the will of God because we can't wait. You know, there's many young people, that I've grown up with. You know, they just can't wait. They say, I want to get married. I want to get married. I want to get married. They don't realize that if they don't get married to the right person, they're going to be miserable. And their life is going to be even worse than they can imagine. They'd rather stay single wanting something than having something that they don't want. And it's so important that we seek the will of God in every aspect of our life. But when you do marry the right person, you know, then your life is, you know, it is truly a blessing from the Lord. And when you are in his will, it truly is a blessing from God because you say, God, I don't want what my flesh wants, but I want what you want. And I believe that if every single Christian child of God would pray in this manner, ask God in this manner, seek God in this manner, I'm telling you, our churches would be different, our services would be different. Literally, Christianity would be different than we know today. But what we see around us is many people that profess Christ, but don't walk the way of Christ. The way of Christ is not just going to church, not just understanding the message of the cross. The way of Christ and the cross is to live out that cross, to live out what Christ did for you on the cross, to live it out every single step you take, that you would live out that life. What I say, what I do, all these simple, practical things that when you focus and when you plug into the right source, which is the cross of Christ, and you let the Holy Spirit work in your life, I'm telling you, it works. The Spirit will lead you. The Spirit will say, do this, but don't do that. Don't go there, but go there. You know, he'll even show you what friends to have. There's times that God told me, Mark, don't have those type of friends. I didn't know. I just shook hands with them the very first time. There were people that went to Bible college with me. I shook hands, hey, you know, what's your name? And they would give me their name. And something within me said, don't be their friend. I didn't tell them, hey, you know, God told me not to be your friend. No, I just kept it myself. And I noticed that every single person that God told me not to be their friend. Don't fellowship with them. None of them are in Bible college anymore, and some of them have left, in embarrassing manners. Either school kicked them out, or through their own sin, that they had to leave. So, the Spirit will always show you, always point to you what you need to do and what you don't need to do. But the key is to be listening. To be listening. I think, every single one of you, have a great pastor, Pastor Matt, and you listen to his word that comes from this pulpit about the cross, about living the message of Christ, living it out in our lives, doing what needs to be done in our lives and in our hearts. And it's important, like I said, that we do it, that we live it out, that we completely surrender everything to God. And I want to continue on a little bit further. I want to stay on the same verse for 30 minutes. Then cometh Jesus unto a place called Gethsemane, and saith unto the disciples, sit ye here while I go and pray yonder. And he took with him Peter and two sons of Zebedee, and began to be very sorrowful and very heavy. Then saith he unto them, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here and watch with me. And he went a little further and fell on his face and prayed, saying, O my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. I want to repeat those words. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. Jesus was telling the Father, if there was another way that man can be saved, man can be redeemed, I would go that way, but there is no other way. There was no other way but the way of the cross. That was the only way. That was the only way. We see here that Jesus had to submit. I want to mix surrender with submission. That Jesus had to submit to the will of God, like I already spoke about. And submission means obedience, resignation, a yielding of one's will of appointment or God without murmuring. That means you don't complain about the way that God's leading you, but you follow it faithfully. You follow the will of God faithfully. In Philippians chapter 2, verse 13, it says, for it is God who works in you both to will and to do for his good pleasure. God gives us both the desire and the ability to do his will. Like I already said, that when Christ died on the cross, he paid for that. He paid not only that our sin would be removed, but that we would live in the power of the, of sin not having dominion over our life. That we would live the newness of life. That we would live, in Christ Jesus. That's what God wanted, that his will and to do for his good pleasure. Because if God just left us at who works in you both to will and just left us at that, said, okay, God gives you the will, but he never gives you the to do, we would be a miserable people. We see a lot of Christians are living the miserable Christian experience because of that. They understand that they need to do the right thing, but they don't understand how to do it. It's the same God who's going to give you the desire for truth, is going to make that truth real to you. The key is to be plugged into him, to be plugged into where the power is coming from. And that power is coming from the cross of Christ. The authority that we have, the will that we need to live out in our lives is already in him. And the more we know the Father, the more we know what the Father wants us to do. And it's having a deeper relationship with him. And I love it here. It says, who works in you both to will and to do. And I don't know if some of you have memorized Philippians 2:13, but it's important, I think that you should spend some time and memorize it. For it is God who works in you both to will and to do for his good pleasure. That's what it comes down to. It's all for his good pleasure. It's for the pleasure of God. And I'll tell you, when you're saved and you're having God's giving you the desire, God's giving you the ability to do that desire in the heart that He has placed in you, it's always going to be for the pleasure of God. But not only for God, but the pleasure for you. Because you're the child of God. Amen. Always going to be for your good pleasure. God didn't have certain things, you know, planned out before time ever began. Because he wants to make our lives miserable. You know, that's what a lot of people and Christians think. That I'm living a miserable life. You know, I'm saved. I go to church. I pray. You know, I read the Bible. You know, I fellowship with believers. I worship the Lord. They think, you know, that I'm living a miserable life. Mark, you know, people work. Say, Mark, why don't you go with us to the club? Why don't you go party with us? Here, Mark, here's a beer. Why don't you drink this? Why don't you do this? Why don't you look at this? Why don't you do that? See, people, you know, on Christians, and even some Christians have in their minds that living the Christian life is so miserable. It's so sad. It's just, around you, you just say no to everything. You know, you're in the closet praying 24 hours a day. You know, you're walking around with your head down. You're very humble like. But that's not the Christian life. The Christian life, as Jesus said, that He came to give us life, not just life in salvation, but life and life more abundantly. He came to save us and for us to live that saved life abundantly. Living a Christian is not sad. It's not depressing. You know, I look at them and say, I don't understand why. You barely come to work. You know, your eyes are red. You're barely making it. You know, you say, you know, it's so good. You know, your life, your partying is so good. You know, but instead you are paying, you know, for three kids' child support. You know, she's always calling you up, hounding you. The court's always hounding you. They're always, you know, getting on top of you. And you're saying you're living a good life. You literally survive paycheck to paycheck and, you know, you're barely making it. But this is such a good life. It's so fun. It's so awesome. I'm telling you, when you get saved, it is so much different. Living the Christian life is awesome. It's amazing because you have Christ dwelling, living in you. It's not, you know, it's just like looking at them and the sorrow and the sadness fills your heart. It's not condemnation, you know, because that's the way I grew up and with, they would condemn people like that. There's people within the church that would get excommunicated. You know, I had, you know, people I grew up with, you know, because of their sins, young people, because, you know, they slept around, because, you know, they drank, they went to parties, the church would excommunicate them. There was about 200 members, you know, 148 kids. So, you know, the church, you know, had a lot of children, a lot of young people. Well, kids were up to the age of 18. So 148 children and 190, you know, from 18 and up. But they would excommunicate people because they didn't live up to their standards. And they would publicly announce the person's name in front of everybody. They would say, you know, let's say, pick a Russian name, Oksana. It's a Russian name. You know, because of Oksana, because she did this and this sin, we excommunicate them from the church. None of you are to have any fellowship with her. You are to look at her as an unbeliever. And not only that, you know, you can talk about her behind her back. You can laugh at her. You can talk, you know, all trash about her. Now, they didn't say that, but that's, you know, literally what they did. But they would say, you know, the person's name, and don't talk to them. You can have no fellowship with them. You know, I have people, you know, person after person getting excommunicated because people didn't live up to the standard. But when it was the deacon's son, they gave him grace and mercy for, you know, years. Last time, you know, I left, they still never excommunicated him. They said, well, we are working with him. You know, we're working with him. So some people they would pick out and say, you're excommunicated. Other people, it's all right. You know, it's good. You know, God's grace is still working in their life. You know, but that's not the way it needs to be. You know, and a lot of these people that fell into the sins, I'll be honest with you, were more righteous than the leadership itself. Because the leadership itself would point these people, you know, point their nose down and condemn them and name false names on them. And there's so much mess. I didn't want to get into it. There was so much mess you know, within religion, and they were always trying to condemn you, always pointing down at you, always saying you're wrong, you're wicked, you're this and that, but they never gave you hope. They would never give you how to live for God, how to move in the, how to listen to the voice of God. But it's listen to me because I am God. You know, as one pastor even said, he said, I am a mediator between God the Father and you. I mediate for you. And this is within a Pentecostal church, not, you know, a Catholic church. But, you know, as back to my subject, you know, I got off a little bit off there. But the point I was trying to make is that, you know, that we are to live our lives according to the will of God. That we don't, you know, it's not within us, you know, to want to do those things. You know, that's submitting to God. I know the more you submit to God, you say, God, I want your will and all my will done in my life, that all the desires start fading away for other things. Even the desires for things that aren't wicked, aren't bad. You know, sports aren't bad. You know, some movies aren't bad. But the desire starts to shift away from those things. You start wanting less and less of that, and you just want more of Him. Amen. And it's not because those things are bad and those things are wicked, but you just don't want nothing really to do with it. It doesn't interest you like it used to, because you want to know the heart of God. Amen. You want to know who He is. 10 minutes is not enough anymore. 20 minutes is not enough. Then you start, you know, going crazy and waking up actually in the morning to seek His face. Because you want Him now in the morning. Then by the time you go to bed, you want Him. When you sleep, you want Him. You wake up, you want Him. Every step you take, you want the will of God. You say, God, I want your will and your way to be done in my life. And Jesus here spoke the words to disciples. He said, watch and pray that you enter not into temptation. It's very interesting where Jesus said this. He said, watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. If Jesus said, watch and pray that you enter not into temptation, that means if you aren't watching and you aren't praying, it means you're falling into temptation. That's what it means. If you aren't watching and you aren't praying, you are falling into temptation. As a kid, I grew up, what they would tell you is you just pray more. You just pray more. Just pray harder, speak in tongues more, you know, pray 30, 40 minutes a day, just pray more. But that's not what this verse is saying. The verse that Jesus is saying, He's saying, watch and pray. What are we to watch? What are we to watch as believers? His coming. His coming, brother said that, right?
Yeah.
His coming, we are to watch for that. We are to keep our eyes focused on Him. So that when He comes, we are ready for Him. We are to watch, to be alert. You know, as I wrote, keep our focus on Christ. That's what Jesus was saying. Keep not just your focus, but your faith in Him. To have your faith planted only in Christ, not within yourself and Christ. Not trying to hold on to two things, but only Him. And Him alone. And it says, and pray. That means to seek His face. You know, prayer is not just spending 30 minutes of communication with God in the morning or in the evening or during the noontime, but prayer is living a lifestyle of being in communion with God. It's not just saying words for 20, 30 minutes. Like I said, you know, thank you, Lord. You know, bless this food, God. I thank you for the abundance. Bless in Jesus' name. Amen. That is a type of prayer, but prayer, you know, truly as we see in the Spirit that Apostle Paul said, he said, pray always. Pray without ceasing. Don't ever stop. That means you're living a continual life of always seeking the will of God, always looking to Him, always watching Him, always looking to His will and His way. And we see in Luke chapter 22, verse 39 through 46, is the same account given except by Luke. It was interesting that while Jesus was seeking the will of God, while He was praying, He's saying, God, not my will, but your will be done. The Bible says that an angel came to strengthen Him. A literal angel came. to strengthen Christ. And when we pray the will of God, you better bet that the Holy Spirit will be there to strengthen us in our prayer. At times it's so difficult to pray. And I know some of you know what I'm talking about. At times, all you can do is just, you don't even have any words. All you do is just cry out to Him. There's no words that you can describe what's in your heart. No, man, you don't even, yourself can't even understand what's happening. But your heart is just so desperate for Him. Your heart just wants Him so much. All you can do is just cry out to Him and say, you know, you didn't even say anything, you just cry. But I know that even in those moments that the Spirit, He's speaking to the Father on your behalf. He's speaking to the Father on your behalf. As it says in Romans 8, 26 through 30. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. For we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. And he that searcheth the heart knoweth what is in the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestine to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, when he whom he did predestine, them he also called. And whom he called, them he also justified. And whom he justified, them he also glorified. It's saying here that the Spirit speaketh to God on our behalf. This verse, you know, Pentecostals use it as speaking in tongues. And that, you know, within itself is not wrong. But this verse is speaking more than that. It's more than just speaking in tongues to God, but it's the Spirit. While you seek the face of God, it's, as it says, with groanings which cannot even be uttered, when sometimes in your spirit you just sigh within your own spirit, within pain, or you don't even know the answer. But God already in heaven has heard that prayer. Amen. Because the Spirit has interpreted what the need is in your life. And of course, you know, as we know, verse 28, 29, it's not speaking about predestination on whom God has chosen, but on what? Which was the cross of Christ. You know, that the cross of Christ was known before the foundations of the earth, but it's not each and every individual who was predestined. You know, some people are lost, some are saved. That's not what this verse is speaking about, but it is what he predestined, which is Christ and the cross. And who, as the Bible says, whosoever will. And those enter in. But as you know, as it says here, that the will of God, I like this. The will of God is to be conformed to the image of his Son. That is the will of God. So if you don't know what to pray for God's will in your life, pray for that. Say, God, let me be conformed into the image of your Son. Because the Bible says that is the will of God for you. That you be more like Jesus. That you be more like Jesus. That is the will of God for your life. You know, then there's other things. You know, that God, like I said, the job, the house, you know, the career, you know, the relationship, the friends, you know, everything else will follow. But the main important thing is to know, to be conformed to the image of Christ. To be more like Jesus. Because I'll tell you, I noticed in my life, you know, and as the verse says, seek ye first the kingdom of God. When you seek the kingdom of God, everything else is added unto you. Everything else is a byproduct of you being in Him. It's a byproduct that I have the job that I have, that I have a wife, that I'm, you know, that I'm in Bible college at this present moment, that I'm even in Baton Rouge. It's all the will of God. I never would live in Baton Rouge if it wasn't the will of God. You know, I'm not, you know, bashing, you know, Louisiana, but I'm not a fan of the state. You know, I like Tennessee much, much better. But I know that it's the will of God to be here. And every time I go down Blue Bonnet, you know, every time, you know, or I go down to New Orleans or Lafayette, there's bridges, you know, and you just see the swamp, you know. I know that it's the will of God for me to be here, to be in this, you know, in Baton Rouge. I know that's the will of God. That's why I packed everything, my all belongings fit in my Toyota Echo. If you don't know what a Toyota Echo is, it's a small car. I put all my belongings in there. I even fit a refrigerator in there. And everything that I owned, I just packed it in there. And I said, I'm going to Baton Rouge. And nothing is going to stop me. And I'll be honest with you, the first 2 months of being in Baton Rouge, I had no job. I ran out of money. Well, I maybe had like 3 cents in the drawer. Maybe several cents in the car. But that's all I had. And I didn't want to call my mom and say, Mom, I need money. Because I knew if I did that, that's me that's trying to produce the will of God in my life. And that's not God doing it for me. That's me begging my mom. I was 18. I said, I need to grow up. You know, she's already paying for my phone bill. You know, I have to pay for my own gas, my own insurance. You know, I already took care of the insurance for 6 months. You know, but I knew that God called me here, and I didn't want to depend on anyone but Him. If my mom would call me and say, Mark, I feel led by the Spirit send you $200, I would have took it. But I didn't want to call her and say, I need money. And I remember I was crying out to God. I just finished eating lunch, and I was crying out to God. I said, Lord, you know, it's pretty embarrassing. I have to go back to Tennessee. I have nothing. I have to call my mom up soon, tell her, you know, send me some money down so I go back to Tennessee. Halfway through the semester of Bible college, I said, it's not fair that the roommate, the suite mate next to me, the guy living there, he always tells me how God provides him with $500, $1,000. You know, he literally was living Bible college and never worked. He said after 3 years of Bible college or four, he counted up, he received $40,000 in blessing. Wow. God truly did bless him. And I said, I don't understand. It's not fair that you are blessing him. You're not blessing me. Your word says that you are no respecter of persons. And I don't understand, God, why you're blessing him and you're not blessing me. You know, and I don't want to go home, you know, but I'll have to. And anyway, I finished eating. I sat there to read the Bible. And there was a knock on my door. And a brother, his first semester too, came and he had a lasagna in his hand. I know he went to, I think, some restaurant. I think Cheesecake Bistro. I don't know if it's a lasagna. They might not. But one of those restaurants. And it was a nice lasagna. I do remember that. And he said, Brother, he said, God told me to give this to you. That's all he said. Brother, God told me to give this to you. I'll tell you, he has never told me that since then. So I knew it was God. He used those words. He said, God has told me to give this to you. That's all he said. I looked at it. I said, oh, thanks. And when the door closed behind me, the Spirit made it so real to me. He said, Mark, as you were worrying about what you were going to eat, what was going to happen tomorrow, what was going to happen a week later, because I had about a week's worth of food. He said, I didn't really need to drive around the car, so it didn't really matter, but I had about a week's worth of food, but I was worrying about 2 weeks later what's going to happen, a week later what's going to happen. And the Spirit spoke to me. He said, well, if you're worrying about right now, 2 weeks later in advance, when my belly's already full, you know, but I want to provide for you today. I want to be your provision today. And I literally fell on my knees and I cried out to God and said, God, thank you. And I'll tell you, God provided the finances. Instead of someone giving me money, He gave me a job. You know, but I didn't mind. You know, I was perfectly all right with that. God wanted to give me a job and wanted me to give me a job. You know, and He gave me a job, and then, you know, He just kept on blessing from them. Gave me another job, you know, and then, you know, someone finished paying for my school semester. Another brother gave me $1,000 to start off my next semester. You know, and I saw the provision hand of God continually blessing. Continually blessing. I don't want to share about the times that I haven't really been in the will of God. You know, because we all have those kind of stories. But it's good to be reminded of the times that we are in the will of God. When we stay in the will of God. When we do what God wants us to do in our hearts and in our lives. And we see here, like I said, that the main important thing that God wants us to do is to be conformed to His Son. If you forget anything I have said today, I want you to remember, pray the will of God for your life to be more like Jesus. Say, God, I want to be more like you. I want to be more like you each and every day. Anything that I do. Anything that I do. I mean, I'm telling you, life is so short. I'm pretty sure you that are older understand that. You know, I'm still young, but you know, it seems like as time goes on, it literally flies too. You know, for us young people, flies. You know, I look a year back, and you know, wow, a year has flown by. You know, maybe for you older people, you know, it goes by a little quicker, but life goes by so fast. And if we aren't seeking the will of God, we will miss what God wants for us. Amen. And I don't want you to the time where you get to the grave, where you're supposed, you know, where you get to the grave. I truly want each one of us, or when Jesus comes back for the church, for truly to rest in peace. That's the reason they put it on there, is rest in peace. Not because it means rest in peace means you're resting in peace, knowing that your life was full. Most Christian, most unsaved people put rest in peace on their tombstone, and they never, ever do rest in peace. They have eternal turmoil. But for us who are saved, we can live in peace right now, and we will live in peace forever. Yeah. I'll be honest with you, eternity starts now for you. When you said yes to Jesus, eternity started. Because all death is just a passing from one place to another. That's all it is, just a passing from one stage of life to another. And in conclusion, I want to say, you know, read Matthew 6, verse 10. In Jesus' prayer, he said, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." That's why he put it in the Lord's Prayer. The prayer pattern for us to pray is for thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Your kingdom, it's all about him. And it's all about his will. And I pray that each one of you would leave this place maybe with a little bit more knowledge or a little bit more understanding or a awakening. Maybe, you know, not a trouble, but, you know, stirring in your spirit to say, "Lord, I want to know your will. I want to know your will." It don't matter if you have messed up for 10 years straight. You haven't been living in the will of God. That you start living in his will and his way. Not just things that on the external look good, but things that he has planned for you. He'll send you to places you never imagined. I know my sister right now is in Africa, you know, as a missionary, married a pastor there. You know, God sent her there. He left me here in Baton Rouge. You know, he has, you know other people, you know, different places in my family, the ones that are truly following his will. And then there's other people in my family, I know they're not following the will of God. And all I see around them, it might seem good, their life, but when I talk to them, there's such a distance from God. They're so distant from God because they're not following in his will and in his way. And that's my prayer, that you in this place would follow the will of God. Follow the will of your Father. Nothing else. Follow his will. Doesn't matter your age. Follow his will. Follow the will of God. I don't know if someone, you know, comes here and plays music, or I don't know how you guys do it. But I want to pray that the will of God would be done in every single one of your lives.